What's up, everyone, and welcome back to Hate Watchers. Today we wrap up our weekly Halo coverage with the Season 2 finale episode, Episode 8, entitled Halo. Let's get right to the breakdown, which means spoilers ahead. We open up with Master Chief at some kind of AI robo-therapy for iconic heroes who were abused by disrespectful creators. Then the show implies that Master Chief is more insignificant than a speck of bacteria that Keyes is looking down on through a microscope. In her lab, Keyes is intrigued by these no longer dormant spores, and her Chatty Kathy assistant won't shut the fuck up, so Keyes banishes her. Out in the hallway, the assistant decides to take a new approach in her life, and she considers adopting lesbianism. Her new lifestyle quickly takes a toll on her, and she decides she's not a lesbian. Now, it's clear that she's been flooded with some pathogen, and she at least knows that, lesbian or not, she definitely hates men. Elsewhere, Corporal Spartan Perez is freaking out about her first deployment, and Kai tries to steady the new Spartans, saying, "Come on, ladies, you are strong and capable of anything," right before the doors get blown off and they get obliterated. Now Kai is soaring through space and deftly maneuvering without any kind of propulsion system. Either that, or the creators were too cheap and lazy to create the visual effects for it. Meanwhile, Master Chief is like, "Fuck this noise," but Admiral Patel calls him and says, "Please reach the Halo first." And even though that was Master Chief's objective anyway, he says no, just to spite her, which makes no sense. We leave this important stuff for Quan, who's talking to Stronghand about some crap her dad told her in the past, as the show makes a lame attempt to tie her horseshit story in Season 2 to her bullshit story in Season 1. Ackerson, meanwhile, seems pretty at home in jail, where he's being creepy to Stronghand's wife and son. And of course, the flood-infected girl is here, because you would totally just throw the insane, murdering, sweaty girl with mushrooms coming out of her fucking ears in a cell. Perez, Kai, and the Spartan Threes board a Covenant ship and come across some Covenant, and in no time at all, the new Spartans are getting their shit pushed in. The UNSC fleet shows up to save the day and immediately gets their shit pushed in too. In the distance, Master Chief leaves his friends' lives up to chance as he flips a coin. God damn it, let this stupid reference go already. The Admiral orders Master Chief to get back in that cockpit, and he tells her to go pound curry, and then he puts on his armor for the first time in 5 episodes. Tits Makee, who clearly still has feelings for Master Chief, learns that he and Cortana used to be close, and she reacts as expected. The Spartan chicks are still finding time to bicker and complain in the midst of this firefight. But they miraculously manage to reach their objective. Perez is grievously wounded with her oblique completely blown off, and Kai thinks she's never been more attractive. But Perez is saving herself for coin-flipping Master Chief, so she tells Kai to go plug in her spike somewhere else. Before she can, however, coin-flipping Master Chief is here, and he's using the energy sword cheat code to fight off some elites. Kai delivers this I Am Sam moment.
Spartans never die. But they do. Don't they?
And everyone prepares to leave the ship. Elsewhere, Quan and Stronghand shuffle around an abandoned mannequin factory. In the jail, the flood-infected chick starts to show her true colors, and Ackerson saves the day. He's a good guy now. The other former bad guy, Admiral Patel, calls in Halsey to try and get through to John, who's busy hurtling toward a seemingly empty Covenant ship. And then we flash back or forward to Master Chief's robotherapy. Aboard the Covenant ship, Master Chief now seems to suddenly care for Cortana, which comes out of nowhere, and he discovers that she's now part of the ship. And that ship is in the middle of crashing into the Halo ring, so Master Chief punches the console before him, which somehow transfers Cortana into his system. Okay. Stronghand and Quan show up to bust their homies out of the clink, including Ackerson, who's joined the Aryan Brotherhood during his very brief time in prison. Master Chief wakes up on the Halo ring, and I was right! What are the odds that the first thing Master Chief does on the Halo ring is take off his helmet? My prediction comes true, as the first thing Master Chief does on Halo is take off his helmet. Cortana is alive as well, as is the Halo ring itself, apparently. Then Cortana guides him to a building on the horizon, and Master Chief says it's so nice to have you back, like he didn't hate her fucking guts for the entire preceding season. Tits Makee and the Arbiter also made it onto the Halo ring, and Cortana revisits the Master Chief Chosen One theme. Up in orbit, Kai pulls a holdo maneuver and sears the commandeered ship into the Covenant capital ship, and pretty much the entire explosion happens off-screen as we instead look at these two chicks' faces. And Command is utterly thrilled that Kai is dead. Halsey is communicating with Keyes when she spots a super spreader straight from Wuhan, and suddenly everyone who was fine 12 seconds ago is part of the flood. But miraculously, not any of the main characters. Don't worry. And we say thank you, come again, to Admiral Patel as she's washed under by the flood. Quan is about to get washed away too, and everything is about to be right in the universe, but then she slips back into her vision quest nonsense. And apparently, her ancestors are working to put the flood on pause for her so she can escape. What the fuck is this? Halsey calmly visits Keyes like there wasn't a fucking zombie outbreak on the bridge 20 seconds ago, but that's probably because she's now part of the flood. Then Keyes is horrified to discover that her mom has a hickey. Stronghand's wife locks the door behind everyone else to ensure their escape, and she shows Stronghand that she has a hickey on her arm and is simply too embarrassed to be seen outside. Tits McKee and the Arbiter reach the ultimate MacGuffin of the season, but then Master Chief arrives and he and the Arbiter fight for McKee's favor or something. Things look dire for Master Chief, but then he says,
"I didn't hear no bell."
And he uses the grappling system from Halo Infinite to beat the Arbiter into alien pulp. The Arbiter begs for the sweet release of death and ultimately freedom from this shit show, and then McKee cries and Master Chief gets jealous and kills him. Bye bye, Arbiter. We hardly knew ye. Then McKee high-fives the MacGuffin and we cut away to Stronghand escaping, with Ackerson sitting in the passenger seat like a good boy. And Halsey and her daughter's relationship once again turns ice cold, this time because Keyes puts her mother on ice to stop the spread of the cooties infection. Kai is dead. Or not. Who knows? Who cares? And McKee tells the Chief that the Halo's power and purpose is to begin things anew. But Master Chief gets distracted by some buildings rising out of the ground on the horizon because he's scared that the Mole people have finally decided to make their move. McKee disappears into the structure before them, and Master Chief high-fives the MacGuffin too. Then we jump forward or backward or sideways to Chief's therapy session, and we realize that he's talking to 343 Guilty Spark, who zips off down the hallway. Master Chief puts on his inexplicably broken helmet so that even when he has his helmet on, he still kinda doesn't. Because we need to end this season with a big middle finger to the fans. And with that, the episode and the season come to an end. Well, we've reached that point in the video where we have to decide whether this finale episode was a great watch or a hate watch. And I think it will come as no great surprise that we end this season with another hate watch. Although to be fair, this episode was better than previous episodes, largely just thanks to all the action they had to cram into this episode to wrap everything up. Most of that action was actually pretty good too, some of the best this season has had to offer. And that's even taking into account the gratuitous use of sparks incorporated to mask where the show was cheaping out on their VFX budget. Of course, even though this season has spent most of its time making people not care about what happens, there's still just a glimmer of enjoyment to be had by seeing Master Chief arrive on Halo after two seasons. And, this one has a qualifier too, even though their sudden buddy-buddy relationship is forced and contrived and comes entirely out of nowhere, there's something to be said about Master Chief having Cortana back and the prospect of their relationship going forward. But the praise has to end there. Because rather than pushing ahead strong through the finale, almost every single storyline this season had to offer fell flat on its face right at the finish line. Not that they were going anywhere anyway, but still, they all flopped in spectacular fashion. Quan's vision quest makes even less sense than when it started. Perengoski and Master Chief just silently swapped objectives between this episode and the last one, which was probably the most bizarre development. Somehow she ninja'd his brain with reverse psychology and tricked him into doing what she had originally wanted him to do. So it's funny that reverse psychology, the thing that only works on animals and small children, worked on Master Chief. Beside literally just the event of Master Chief reaching Halo, there wasn't much resolution to anything else. McKee's motivations are still pretty muddy, Quan's vision quest took a complete left turn, the flood just started spreading and we have no idea to what extent that will continue, Ackerson is alive and off the hook. I guess for the sake of being fair, Soren's wife's storyline got wrapped up nicely, and while we didn't really care for the end of Perengoski's story, it at least had some closure. But even those storylines required someone's death for any level of closure. Everything else is just up in the air, and I can't see this as being anything more than another trick to get people to tune in to the next season. And there was no real feeling of triumph over this season's villains. Ackerson is just calmly riding shotgun with Soren at the end, and Perengoski's justice was delivered by the mindless flood, rather than our heroes besting her. It's a less than satisfying ending in that regard, to say the least. As for seeing how they've chosen to handle the flood, it's different than what we expected, I'll say. It seems they want to take a very zombie horror-inspired approach to the galactic menace, and I don't know if it's really to my tastes, but I think it's just going to be exactly that, up to everyone's individual tastes. All in all, I think this episode was a slight uptick in quality over the rest of the season, but not nearly enough to move any needles or change any minds. What did you think about this finale? What was your opinion about how they portrayed the Flood? Do you get the feeling that leaving so many things up in the air is intended to try and retain viewers going into a potential third season? Let us know in the comments. And remember to stay tuned to the channel for the complete season review video, which should be up tomorrow, and a video of the funniest clips and scenes from this season of Halo. Also, remember to like the video if you liked it, and consider subscribing to HateWatchers for reviews of other current shows and movies. Thank you for getting washed away by the Flood with us today, and we'll catch you on the next one.